Alright guys, so we are finishing today the discussion of processor architectures. The first thing though I want to come back to is how jumps are implemented. I think that got cut off from the last lecture. So when we have a jump instruction, we will have some set of bits that encodes the fact that this is a jump instruction, and then we have an address of the label to which we want to jump to. Okay, so again, we're going to combine this address here from the instruction with the program counter because we're doing program counter relative addressing. Okay, so what we're going to take is take the top bits of the old program counter. We're going to shift these 26 bits left by 2, and that's because the addresses are aligned on 4 bits. And then we'll end up with 00 in the least significant bits of the address. That's fine. Again, addresses are lined up on 4 byte boundaries. Okay, so the way this gets added to our control path is we're going to take the value of the program counter, increment it by 4, and that is going to be one of the options, one of the data paths here. The other part we'll take from the instruction. So we have the jump instruction and the address in here. We'll take the address, we'll pass it to here, shift it by 2, okay, combine it with the program counter, and that will go into this multiplexer. So if the instruction that we're decoding is in fact a jump, then this line, this jump line, will be set, and we will pass this value here. Let me get my pointer. Then we will pass this value here through the multiplexer back into the program counter for the next instruction. Okay, so this wraps up our basic data path example. Now, we want to potentially speed this up or look at the performance issues. So the delay of this data path, basically how long it takes for the signals to traverse this whole path, depends on the clock speed, right? The different functional components are triggered by a rising clock voltage. And so depending on how frequently those clock ticks are, or the more frequent they are, the more frequently we will invoke the different components. But each of the components still needs some time to process, so we can't make the clock infinitely fast. Okay. The difficulty there is that the longest path through this is for the load instruction, which ends up using all the functional units. And the reason for that, I can kind of back up, is we need to read the instruction, we need to look into the registers, we need to compute the address that we're loading from, then we need to read data from memory, and then finally we need to write back the results we loaded into the register bank. Okay, so the load instruction will use all the different functional units. But load instructions are not too frequent, so this becomes an issue here. So if we have a fast instruction, maybe just like an arithmetic instruction, it doesn't need to use the memory at all, so it could be faster, but the data path needs to be designed to cater to all instruction types because we want to be able to use the hardware between instructions, so we don't want separate data paths. And so we can't really vary the execution period for different instructions. Okay? So this violates the principle of making the common case fast. Why is that? Well, the load instructions are actually not that common. They do happen in, I guess, every or most programs, but a lot of the other operations have to do with arithmetic operations purely based on registers. And so our pipeline is, or our data path is kind of slowed down to these load instructions, whereas arithmetic instructions could potentially execute faster. Okay? So we can improve the performance of this sample or this example processor by pipelining. Okay, so let's talk about an analogy of doing 4 loads of laundry. What are the different tasks that you would need to do? Well, you can kind of think through the process and realize that first you need to wash your clothes, then you need to dry them, then you need to fold them, and then you need to put them away. right? So there's sort of four stages in this pipeline. And for simplicity's sake, let's assume that each of these tasks takes the same amount of time, okay? So one way to do this is you can execute the different tasks in order, and when you're done putting away the clothes from the first load, you can start washing the clothes in the second load, etc., etc., and then you're not done until 2 a.m. So obviously this isn't the most clever way of doing a bunch of loads of laundry, but with the data path that we have designed, this is basically what you're doing. You're doing each load of laundry at a time. So obviously we could speed this up by using some parallelism where we start a wash of laundry, and then when we're using the dryer for the first load, the second load goes in the washer, okay? And then when the first load is being folded, the dryer becomes free and we can move the clothes from the second load from the washer to the dryer and then start using the washer for the third load, okay? So basically we can pipeline this and get all those loads of laundry done much more quickly, okay? We're kind of done here at 9:30. So one thing we could ask is how much faster is it to use this pipeline laundry system instead of the sequential laundry system? Well, we can analyze this based on the four loads that we're doing. So the speed up would be a factor of about 2.3. Why? Well, it took us 8 hours to do these loads of laundry sequentially, but when we parallelized them, this only took us 3.5 hours. Okay, save 1 hour, second hour, third hour, and then a half hour. So the speed up would be about 2.3, okay? What if we had an infinite number of loads? Okay? How much faster would this be? So basically, if we had an infinitely long program or a very long program, what kind of speed up could we expect? Well, we can look at the number of how long the pipeline takes. Okay, so this would be 2 hours. So we can have here 2 divided by how long is each stage, which is half an hour, okay? And then we can add the initial start time, right? So we have kind of 1, 2, 3 halves of hours before the pipeline becomes full, okay? So we can think of it as there's some startup time, and then in each cycle, we can execute, we can use all the functional units in this infinitely long pipeline, okay? So we have basically 2 hours divided by half hours plus this initial starting time. And so we get the speed up of about 4, which translates to basically the number of stages. Okay. There's, of course, some, so you might think that by adding more stages, you can get more speed up. And that is generally the case, although there are some diminishing marginal returns of just increasing the number of your pipeline stages because of some extra overhead and inefficiencies that happen in the pipeline. What it comes down to is that it becomes difficult to actually keep the pipeline full at all times, and I'll show you guys examples of why that would happen. Okay. So let's create a basic pipeline, define a basic pipeline for our processor, and we will define it in terms of 5 stages. So we have the IF stage, or instruction fetch, where we get the instruction from memory. Instruction decode, where we decode what the instruction is supposed to do and read the register values for it. We will have the execute stage, where we engage the ALU to do the calculation. And then we'll have a memory access to either read or write data from memory. And then we'll have a write back stage where potentially some results are written back to a register. Okay. Let's look at our pipeline and see where those different stages are. Okay. So the instruction fetch would be basically here. So the instruction fetch would be here. We have a program counter, we have the instruction memory, and we're going to get the instruction. Once we have the instruction, we need to decode it. That will be by passing the instruction code into the control unit and loading the values from the different registers. Okay? Then we have the execute stage, where we engage the ALU to actually perform the computation we need. Okay, then we have the memory stage where we read data from memory. And finally, the write-back stage passes the result of whatever data we have loaded from memory or computed from the ALU, goes through here, and then back to the registers. And so we need some time to write those back into the register bank. Okay, so those are basically the different stages. We can then kind of analyze their time by seeing how long it takes the different functional units to do their stuff. Okay? So let's say that the instruction fetch takes about 200 picoseconds for load, store, arithmetic, and branch instructions. Register read is faster. It will take only 100 picoseconds. Then we have ALU operation. And then we have memory access. Let's say all those take 200. And then the write back to the register takes another 100 picoseconds. So depending on the type of the instruction, the total pipeline execution of this, or the execution through all the stages of a pipeline, will take a different amount of time. And as you can see, the load instruction is the longest. Okay, so let's compare this with, let's compare those numbers with and without pipelining. So without pipelining, we have a series of instructions, say three instructions. We end up loading a bunch of words into a bunch of registers, and you can see that the whole pipeline takes about 800 picoseconds as we computed before. Okay? So our single cycle, the time to execute an instruction ends up being about 200 picoseconds. Now, when we end up pipelining this data, we can put the stages here like this. Now, the difficulty is that because like here the register access takes only 100 picoseconds, it's shorter than instruction fetch, data access, etc. We have this twice. When we're doing pipelining, however, we need to leave that extra space. We can't simply move up the ALU operation up because it's going to conflict with the other stages of the pipeline. So each operation in the pipeline version of this processor will take 200 picoseconds, which is basically geared to the longest operation of any functional unit. Okay? So then after some startup time, every 200 picoseconds, we are doing a write back to the register. So each instruction ends up being executed every 200 picoseconds. Okay? So the speed up is not quite 5x here. Well, it's because some of the stages take longer, and we'll also see there's a little bit of overhead of managing these different pipeline stages as we pass data from one instruction to another. Okay. So the instructions take less time on average, but a single instruction will actually take longer in a pipeline processor. So what ends up slowing this pipeline is the different hazards that can happen. Okay? And the hazards are situations where we can't really start the next instruction in the next cycle. Right here in the pipeline execution, in every clock cycle, every 200 picoseconds, we're starting a new instruction, but that may not always be possible. Okay? And there are different examples, there are different types of these hazards. Okay, so for a structural hazard, the required resource could be busy. Right? And the example there is that a dryer can take longer than expected because the clothes are extra heavy and they contain more water. And so the dryer is not available when the next load finishes in the washer. Right? You need to kind of insert extra wait time. Right? You can also have a data hazard where we need to wait for the data from the previous instruction to use it in the next instruction. Okay? I'll show you guys some examples in the actual pipeline. The laundry analogy doesn't quite work here. And then we can have control instructions where there is a branch in the program, and so the processor doesn't know which is the next instruction should execute. Okay? So the decision of what to do depends on the result of the previous instructions. Okay? And then, you know, I don't know, you could come up with that, some sort of contrived example. As far as the laundry analogy, for example, do you need to add a fabric softener? And then for that, you need to dry the last batch of clothes to actually see if that's something that you need to be doing. I don't know. Okay. So let's look at the structural hazards first. So what happens here is that we need to load the next instruction. Okay, so we're doing an instruction fetch to start with, and so down the pipeline we're doing an instruction fetch. And so we are fetching this instruction from memory, but there's a conflict because we are also writing to memory at the same time based on the memory access of this instruction. So our functional unit of memory is being used by two different instructions, which is not allowed. There's only so many wires that are attached to memory, so we can either read or write. The way to solve this is to have separate memories for data and instruction. And we don't really want to have a separate memory inside a computer, but what we can have is separate memories inside the processor. Right, so the memory could still be used in a very flexible way by dividing the space between program sort of runtime memory and instruction memory. But then when it comes to the caches inside the processor, we can have a memory, a data cache and an instruction cache. And so that's what's actually happening. So if we go back to our data path, we can see that there's an instruction memory and there's a data memory. Well, there's actually only one memory in this computer, but this should be labeled as data cache and a instruction cache. Okay? And then when we talk about the memory unit, we'll see how these actually end up, these caches end up mapping the data back to system memory. Okay, so we can avoid this conflict between data access and instruction fetch if we have two separate caches in this processor. Otherwise, we would have to store this instruction to be able to access the instruction memory. But, well, then we have a conflict on this, and so we would have to kind of stall this indefinitely until we end up with basically sequential execution. Okay. The second type of hazard you can have is a data hazard. So let's consider this piece of code where we're adding RDI to RAX, and then in the next instruction we are reading from RAX to add it to RBX. Okay, we can look at what happens in the pipeline. So we have the pipeline stages of instruction fetch, instruction decode, execute, memory access, and write back. Okay? What happens here is that during the write back, we are actually writing the value of this computation into the register bank. Well, if we want to use this value in the next instruction, the instruction decode stage should be delayed by two cycles, basically, so that it lines up with this write back. So what we can actually do in hardware is kind of divide the execution of each stage in half so that we can, in the first half of the cycle, write data to the register bank, and then in the second half of the cycle, read data from the register bank. Okay, so this is okay. We don't have to delay it anymore, but we can do this instruction decode here if this instruction was being executed in this row, right? Because the data is not actually written to the register bank yet. Okay, so when we have this dependency, there is this delay that has to be inserted by hardware until we can do a write back. One way to avoid this is you can insert some other instructions here that can proceed, and then this can be done a little bit later because we kind of have two free cycles here. Okay, so we can actually deal with this pretty effectively by having forwarding, also known as bypassing. And the way that could be done is by having a set of wires that forward data from the output of the execute stage to the input of the execute stage. Okay? So when these two instructions are staggered like this, to get the data into the execute stage of the next instruction, we don't actually need to pull it from the register bank. we can use the bypass value as part of instruction decode. And then instead of pulling data from the register bank, instruction decode can say, okay, we're doing an add. We have this dependency. Let's pull the data from this bypass. Okay? So that way there's no cycles lost. Okay, this is a little bit more difficult if we're using a load instruction, because the data is that we need for the next instruction is not actually available at the end of the next stage. Okay, so if we have this load, then we need to potentially use, we can still use the bypass, but we need to use the bypass from memory, which happens one cycle later, and so we still need to insert the stall cycle. Okay. And this stall cycle again can be used by another instruction. So if you're executing load and then subtraction, you can maybe move another instruction from here up if that instruction works on independent registers, and then execute it in this empty cycle while kind of sub is waiting until you can bypass the values into it. So here's an exercise for you guys. This is a piece of code, and your job here is to identify the different data hazards and also how many cycles does it take to execute this piece of code, okay? Assuming that we have stalls. Okay? Then once you have it, you can reorder this code to avoid the different stalls and then see how many cycles you have saved. Okay, so this would be a good time to pause the video. All right, so let's look at this. So we have some data that we're loading from memory into register R1. This is the alternate naming of registers for x86, or for NASAM rather. And then we're going to load some other memory into R2, and then in the next instructions we're going to add R1 and R2 into R3. Okay, great, except now we have a stall here because we have a load instruction followed by the use of this value. Okay, so there's a stall here, and you can keep going and see that there's the same kind of stall here, and so we're losing the a cycle here, right? So when we add up how long it takes to execute this, okay, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 instructions, okay, plus the stalls, okay, plus the length of the pipeline. So we have 7 plus 2, so we're at 9, plus the startup of the pipeline, which is 4, because we have a pipeline stage. So the execution of this code will actually take 13 cycles. Okay, so let's see how we can rewrite this code to avoid the stalls. Okay, we can do the loads. So we have load from R0 plus 4, and then we can move up this load from R0 plus 4. Okay, and now we can do this first add, but now this add is 2 cycles down. So there's no stall because the data is already available. It can be bypassed into the input. And similarly here, the data has been loaded already into R4, and so we can use it. And therefore, we eliminate the 2 stall cycles. And so we can look at the execution time of this code, and it's going to be 2 cycles less, and so 11. All right, so that's pretty nice. By reordering your instructions, you can kind of you can speed up the execution of your code on the processor. And it's one of the optimizations you can start doing in assembly, or if you have a good compiler, the compiler will do this type of reordering for you. Okay. So the last type of hazard is a control hazard, where we need to fetch the next instruction to be executed, but we don't know what the address is because we don't know if a branch is actually being taken or not taken, and so the processor doesn't know which is the next address it should be loading. Okay. So here's an example of this. We're doing an add instruction, great. We're doing a branch on equal instruction, great. But now we don't know if these two registers are equal and if we should be jumping to this address. Okay, so we can stall this, wait for the results from the ALU, okay, and then once we know what address we're loading, right, once we know the result of the comparison here, okay, we know if we're branching, we can then pass this down here into, do a bypass, into instruction fetch, into the instruction decode stage. Into instruction fetch, right? So we know which instruction we're fetching. Okay. So one way to speed this up is to do a prediction of the branch. So if we are encountering a branch on equal instruction or a jump instruction, well, we can predict whether or not this branch will be taken. There are some increasingly sophisticated methods for doing branch prediction. The simplest one is to just kind of assume that a particular branch will be taken or not taken. Okay, so it turns out that most of the branches, when you profile code, most of the branches are actually not taken. Most of the time, the code just falls through without taking the branch. So what you should be doing is loading the instruction for the next instruction in line here, and then if you're wrong, then potentially rolling this back. Okay, so let's look at an example. So we have the case of correct prediction where we have a branch on equal, but we're predicting that we're not going to do a jump. Instead, we're going to execute the next instruction. And so we load that next instruction during instruction fetch, and our pipeline doesn't break. Okay. If, on the other hand, our prediction was incorrect and we ended up jumping to another piece of code, well, then we need to basically delay this. We end up delaying this until we can do instruction fetch once we know the results of the comparison. Okay. So we potentially then need to roll back the results of this load word, okay, and continue our execution of the OR. So this is one of the examples where it's difficult to keep the pipeline fully loaded. Sometimes we need to insert this wasted time and unroll the results of a previous execution. Okay. So let's look at how this pipeline would be implemented in our basic data path. Okay, so we can divide the basic data path into this instruction fetch, instruction decode, instruction execute, memory access, and write back stages. Okay, and so during the write back, we're going to pass the results back here into this into the register bank. Okay, so it turns out that the way to do this, we need to duplicate the different registers, right? So we can't really just use one register bank. We need to use copies of the different registers to pass information along, okay? So when we execute the instruction fetch, okay, we're going to put the result into a set of registers that we'll be then able to use in instruction decode and instruction execute. Okay, so these intermediate registers are kind of copies of the data that can be used by each different stage, so that each different stage can have kind of access to its own memory. Okay. It turns out that program counters also consider a pipeline register that needs to be saved, for example, when we end up executing exceptions. Okay, so let's look at an example of this. We're getting data from the instruction memory, and that goes into the instruction fetch. Okay, so we can save this data while at the same time in another pipeline, pipeline kind of instruction, we needed to read from the set of registers to execute the instruction decode. So So maybe I should back up here to a pipeline. Okay. So what we're doing is we have instruction fetch, and then we need to write data to some set of somewhere. We need to save it somewhere. Okay. While the next pipeline stage is also using the same kind of registers as input. Okay. This is maybe more relevant here, or more easy to illustrate with the ALU, where the ALU takes some set of values, does a computation, and produces some set of values. Okay. But those set of values that ALU reads from, okay, is also the set of values that the instruction decode writes to. Right? So it can't be the same set of registers. We need to kind of split those up. Okay? And this is where this comes in. So the instruction memory can write to some set of values, while the register bank can read those and then write to another set of values. Okay? That prevents the wires being crossed from the same set of wires kind of being used for reading data from instruction decode and writing data into ALU. There's sort of this time separation that we can use through this cache. Okay. So here's an example of a pipeline execution where we read from memory and then we do instruction decode where we read from this data bank, read from registers, and then write to the next set of pipeline registers, etc., etc., etc. Okay. The problem that happens here, okay, is that we're writing data to doing write back, writing data to memory. Okay. So we have some result that comes out of this, and we're sending the data to be written here, but in the instruction fetch, or instruction decode, this instruction decode stage is actually for another instruction, and so the write register value will be different, right? We're executing a different instruction in this stage at the time when we're done with the instruction here in the write back. Right? So even though we're passing value back, the write register is numbers from another instruction, not the instruction we just finished executing over here. All right, so how can we deal with this, right? How can we deal with this wrong register number? Well, what we can do is actually pass the correct write register address through this pipeline. So when we first decoded this instruction, okay, we can write the address of the write back register into this set of pipeline registers and then kind of forward it such that when we do a write back, we can pass in the value that we need to write back, as well as the address or the number or the name of the register that we want to write back to, right? We can do the same type of things for other control signals, where instead of having a single controller, we do the instruction decode, figure out what the control signals should be, and then write those into the pipeline registers and kind of forward them on for the stage, okay? So during instruction decode, we will figure out what is the set of control signals for the different functional units for the execution stage, for the memory stage, and for the write-back stage, and then forward those on. In the execution stage, we can read those control signals, pass those to the ALU, and pass kind of the remaining control signals to the next pipeline register bank. And then in the memory access, we can read those control signals, depending on if the instruction we decoded here was a memory load or a store, pass those to the memory bank, and then so on and so forth during write back. Okay, so what the pipeline actually ends up looking at like is that we do the instruction decode here, pass it to the control, and then we have our register bank for the intermediate values from the instruction decode, as well as the control signals that we're passing on. Those instructions, control signals for the execute stage will be piped into the ALU, into the ALU control, into this multiplexer, and then those from the memory will be used here for the different functional units, such as memwrite and memread. And then similarly, here we will have whether a control signal for this multiplexer, as well as the register write directive here for the register bank. Okay. So that basically sums up our pipeline execution. There's a lot more to pipelining that we cover in the architecture, that we used to cover in the architecture course. If you are interested in more details of how processors are implemented in with kind of more realism, I would suggest you guys right now take a double E course on that stuff. I think it's super fascinating, and we just don't have the time to get into the very, very nitty-gritty of this. But this at least should give you an idea of how things are executed inside a processor, how this is a completely mechanical process without any magic inside, and I hope you find that idea satisfying. The next lecture will be on memory, which will kind of clean up some of the memory concepts that we've been discussing before. So, all right, thank you guys.